Welcome to a brand new day with Praise Tabernacle Church. Now join us for a service already in progress. God bless you, and remember, Jesus died for you.
Powerful time. place made ready for the saints. Anxiously I'm awaiting as time draws closer. Where I stand, I'm blessed either way.
Who am I there? me, and that you knew. Sister Don, it's amazing, yeah. I am a friend of God. Oh, oh, I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. He called me
God. If you need a Bible, we will give you a Bible this morning. We have plenty that we just want to give away. The book of Isaiah, chapter 59. The book of Isaiah, chapter 59. We're going to start in verse 1. I'm not going to read much this morning. The question being, why are we here? Why are we here? Chapter 59, starting in verse 1. Behold, the Lord's hand is not shortened, that it cannot save, neither his ear heavy, that it cannot hear. The Lord has heard every prayer this morning that we have lifted up to the throne of grace. Verse 2 says, but your iniquities have separated between you and your God, and your sins have hid his face from you, that he will not hear. For your hands are defiled with blood, and your fingers with iniquity. Your lips have spoken lies, your tongue has muttered perversions. We're going to stop right there. In order for God to answer prayers, we have to have our life lined up with him. God does not hear the prayer of an unrighteous man unless he's praying for salvation. I want you to hear that again. God does not hear the prayer of an unrighteous man unless he's praying for salvation. Miss Cooper, is that you? No, that's not Miss Cooper. Welcome. God bless you. You look like Miss Cooper. I'm sorry. She's a fine evangelist. Amen. We cannot have God and have the world also. We cannot have both. God has brought this thing down as we preached in the last days, where we have to choose now who we will serve. We have to choose our master. There's no such thing as the middle of the road anymore. There's no such thing as straddling the fence. You are either living for God or you're living for Satan. No two ways about it. You're either in with the church or you're out of the church. You're either praying every day that God have mercy on your soul, or you're going about blindly of the things of the world, not hearing from an almighty God. God wants to hear from his people. God wants to hear the prayer of the righteous man. God also wants to hear that prayer of salvation, that humble prayer. I'm coming to you, Lord. I'm giving my life to you. I'm glad. I'm tired of all of this stuff being in my life. I'm tired of all this sin. I'm tired of all these things coming against my family. I give my heart to you, Lord. Do you know that God desires to hear prayers like that? God desires to hear prayers from you where after you're saved of thanksgiving. Of God, I'm so thankful that you're my God and every day you walk with me, you talk with me. Father God, I'm sending my children to church, knowing to church and to school, knowing that you're going to go with them, Lord. Guide my children's step. Let them live. If we would spend more time in prayer and more time in the Word of God and more time thinking of the things of God and things that are in your future with God, we would have no time to even worry about what the world's doing or much less desire the things of the world. We would have no time for that. God desires to hear from His people. In the Garden of Eden, the Bible says that God took the dust of the earth and He made man and He breathed in his nostrils and He seen that it was very good. Everything that God made, He said it was very good. Everything. He said, let there be light. Amen. And there was light. Let there be a firmament between the heavens and the earth. And there was. And God created man. And then He seen that it wasn't good for man to be alone. So He made man a mate, a helpmate. Eve. There was Adam and Eve in the garden. And they knew God. And they didn't know any evil. They didn't know anything else but God. They walked with God. They talked with God every day. And God was able to be there in the Garden of Eden with man. He made man to commune with man, to talk with man, to bless man. And He blessed them there in the garden. Adam and Eve seeing God face to face. He was there in the garden with them because there was no sin. It was sinless, that Garden of Eden that God made. And God desires to have supplication with the children of God. God desires and yearns to hear you pray, to cry out, God, I need you. God loves to be needed. God loves to come into our lives and bless our finances and bless our health and bless everything. I can't tell Him to bless my cars and my truck.
Yeah.
God bless that old dog out there.
Amen.
Bless him, Lord, that he won't eat so much. You can bless things like that. It's all right. God will bless them. He will give you the desires of your heart. He wants to bless His children. But we have to remember in the Garden of Eden that sin separated us from God. Sin separated man from God. For the Bible says God cannot look upon sin. And when man and woman, and I'll blame it on both of them.
Yeah.
Some people just blame it on Eve because she ate first, but the old boy was dumb enough to follow it.
Yeah. Amen.
So we just blame it on both of them for the fall of the human race. They did what they wasn't supposed to do. Out of all the miracles, the beauty, the things of the Garden of Eden, that great city that God gave them, and said there's only one thing you can't do. And what did mankind do? They did that one thing. They stepped over the line. Out of all the things to do there in that heavenly place, disobedience came into the equation. Satan came in that equation and tempted Eve, and she did eat. Then the Bible says she gave it to her husband, and he did eat. And there, ladies and gentlemen, is where the separation of God began. At the forefront of creation. God couldn't even wait till we got half. I mean, man couldn't even wait till we got halfway through this thing.
Right.
They done it up front, in the beginning. They couldn't wait to sin, to do something wrong, to be disobedient to God. God had to withdraw His hand from mankind. Can you imagine having to sacrifice lambs and goats just so God can forgive your sin? Can you imagine having to go all the time here at the church and have an altar and bring a lamb, a sacrifice, every Sunday after Sunday after Sunday. Bring your best and lay it on the altar and have to sacrifice it and cook it and have to let the blood and the incense and all go up to God's nostrils just to have your sins forgiven. God didn't see any bad thing about that because He just wanted to have communion Amen. With man. It wasn't really that much to ask to cleanse ourselves from unrighteousness, to cleanse ourselves from sin so that God can have supplication with us, so that God can commune with His beautiful creation once again. God created us and He said it was very good. It was beautiful, man. They're going to multiply and heaven is going to be on here on earth, and I'm going to be able to walk with man and I'm going to be able to talk with men. But we messed it up. And that's how we do. When we try to do something, we mess it up. God looked at the sacrifice and He looked at man. And He said, you know, that's just not going to do. It's too hard for them to do. They still can't do it. If it would have been me, I would have just went poof and wiped you off the face of the earth. God can do that. He did it in the Old Testament. There was some kids made fun of a bald-headed prophet one time, and He just opened up the ground and swallowed them. Don't make fun of my prophets. Just got rid of them. And that's how God is. That's how God, the Bible even goes as far as says God was an angry God. God is not angry against mankind, but God is angry against our sin. Like He always had been all the way through the Bible. He is angry with disobedience. That all He asked of us is to love Him and not be disobedient. When my kids were growing up, I wished I could have done that every now and then. That's how what God should have done. Just started from scratch. Man, that's a misfit there. I'm going to make some more. But He didn't, and we didn't. Because we love our children. And we're willing to go through immortal hell for our children. I mean, children will put gray hairs in your head. Children will make you a nervous person when you was always cool as a cucumber. Children will disobey and be disobedient and misbehave and use your love and steal money from you and get on drugs and all kind of things. But you still love them. Unconditionally, you love that child. And you pray for that child. And you say, God, I rebuke Satan. You can't have their soul. That's how God loves you. With an unconditional love this morning. And He wants to have communion with us. He wants to be with us. He misses us. Us. Not the sinful us, but He misses the one He created for a purpose. You have a purpose. That's why you're here. God put us here for a purpose. To be with Him. To commune with Him. Can you imagine how wonderful heaven's going to be? Can you imagine? I preached a lot of funerals in my life. And you know, it's hard to preach a person that died without Christ. It's hard to, all you can do is preach to the family. You can't get up there and lie and say, well, they didn't know God. They're going straight to hell. You don't do anything like that at a funeral. Preachers, you don't do that. You're there to comfort the family. There's ways to preach to the family. God said, do it in love. Preach in love, in season and out of season. Not forbid God that you would offend your brother or your sister in Christ. What you say at that funeral, someone will get saved. And I don't know why I went there, but some of you are just not good with words. Some of you rather just cuss somebody out in a heartbeat and pray for them. I know we would. I've been there before. In traffic, cutting folks off, calling them your little nicknames. Yeah. It's easy to do, isn't it? Especially driving from Atlanta every day. It's real easy to do. We are only human, but that's why God cannot commune with us. A funeral where a saved person has passed away, you can have revival. You can celebrate that life. You can celebrate because they are in that place called heaven. They are in that place where there's no more sin, no more dying, no more separation from God. How do we commune from God on this side? Why are we here? The world, you can't live halfway in the world and halfway in the church and expect to hear from God. We can't do that. There's a bloodstained banner that we have to hold high and say, I'm on the side of Jesus. I'm on the side of the church. I'm on the side of the righteous. I'm on the winning side. I have victory in Jesus. Let me tell you something. I've tried a lot of drugs, a lot of alcohol, a lot of things of the world. They didn't do me like Jesus does. They just made me sick and destroyed everything that God had given me in my life that was precious to me. That's all it does is take away from you the things of the world. You sit and you wonder and you say, man, they're out there having fun. No, you're not having fun until you know Jesus. Amen. Amen? I think the online dating is the best thing to ever come up with. You know why? Because you don't have an excuse anymore to go to a bar. Because used to, that's about the best place to meet a woman if you was lonely as a bar. And you had an excuse. Well, I didn't have any other place to go. Well, now there's E and G and E dating and you name it. Christian.com, we match them. All that good stuff. Am I telling the truth? Technology can be a curse or it can be a blessing. Somebody, Brother Andy met his girlfriend, wonderful woman of God, online. I was hoping you'd be here. We don't have an excuse anymore to be disobedient to God. God's putting things in front of us that half of us don't even recognize. And then we use it for the bad things instead of the good things and the blessings that God has sent it for us to do. God sent that technology so that, yes, there's lonely people in the world. And He knows that. Listen, this is life. We're not living a fantasy world. If you're lonely, you're lonely. God expected you to have someone, but He didn't expect you to settle. He didn't expect you to settle to the first one that comes along. He wants to send you a godly man or a godly woman. And that way He can commune with both of you. The Bible says that you become as one. There's a right way and a wrong way to do things. You're supposed to fall in love and get married. Men, you're supposed to romance that lady. Give her flowers. Take her out. And then she pays for it because women don't ever do nothing anyway. Except get the goodies. Come on, that's funny.